So as a human-computer interaction researcher, my expertise lies at the intersection of social computing and privacy. I'm interested in trying to understand how people use technology to connect with one another while simultaneously trying to use it to protect themselves. Hence my talk today on social media and privacy. So when we often talk about privacy, we often talk about it in terms of transactional privacy, of the information that we want to protect and hold dear to ourselves. For instance, we talk about the passwords that we want to keep secure, or that we want to keep it safe to not share our social security numbers or our birth dates with others online unintentionally. However, when it comes to social media, privacy is much more complex. And in fact, it's actually quite social. For instance, deciding whether or not to accept that friend request is primarily relational, but it also has a number of significant implications for your personal privacy. So when I started conducting research on the topic of social media and privacy, I went back to the theories of social psychologist Erwin Altman, who defined privacy as an interpersonal boundary process by which a person or group regulates interactions with others by altering the degree of openness of self to others. So Altman, who did his work in physical spaces and face-to-face interactions, identified a number of boundary mechanisms that we as humans use to negotiate these interpersonal boundaries with others. Some of the most commonly cited ones in his work are eye contact, our personal space or boundaries, and our body language. In his seminal work, The Environment and Social Behavior, Altman argued that we should attempt to design responsive environments, which permit easy alteration between the state of separateness and a state of togetherness. He went on to say that environments that emphasize only either very little interaction or a great deal are too static and will not be responsive to changing privacy needs. Well, a lot has changed since 1975. With the advent of the internet and social media, some have claimed that privacy is dead. And others, like the CEO of Facebook, Mark Zuckerberg, have explained that sharing is just our new social norm and that the design of our systems should reflect this new social norm. So while we are now in an era of frictionless sharing, so sharing is made easier and easier, managing one's privacy through social media has become more and more complex. Because those boundary mechanisms that Altman defined for regulating our interactions with others in the real world don't translate very well to virtual environments, we now have to make very explicit privacy decisions online. For instance, setting our global privacy settings, deciding when we want to give access to ourselves to others, when and to whom, deciding what type of information is appropriate to share and to what audiences, trying to make it where others don't encroach on our personal space, deciding when a friendship has become counterproductive or possibly abusive, trying to remove ourselves from embarrassing situations online, making sure that our personal information isn't broadcasted to the world, and then setting up some more permanent boundaries of denying access to ourselves to certain others altogether. Now, with this myriad of different privacy options, this led me down the paths of asking, how do people really manage their privacy through these social networking sites? So today I'm going to be presenting some of the high-level results of two of the studies that I've worked on with my collaborators on how people manage their privacy differently on social media. First, I conducted 21 interviews with social networking site users. I asked them generally about how they manage their social interactions with others and how they manage conflicts once it's arrived. One of the reasons that I didn't explicitly ask them about their privacy and how they use privacy settings is that we didn't want to prime users to understanding how they manage their social behaviors. From this study, I did find that people manage their privacy differently. And what I found is that there are certain users who manage their privacy through self-censorship, by not putting anything out there because they want to stay safe. But there's also another number of users who take other approaches as well. For instance, individuals who share a great deal within their social networks, but they manage their privacy by only sharing with intimate friends and family members. And so I wanted to really confirm and dig into these different profiles of privacy management strategies that I was seeing in the qualitative data. So I conducted a web-based survey with 308 Facebook users. What I did in this study is that I asked them to actually log into their Facebook accounts, and I had them navigate to every privacy setting and privacy feature that was available in Facebook. I think the survey took a lot of people like over an hour and a half to do. And I had them report on their current privacy settings, as well as the frequency in which they would use certain privacy controls available in the Facebook user interface. After we had this data, we used confirmatory factor analysis to reduce these different privacy features and behaviors into stable constructs. And then we did a mixture factor analysis to identify six emerging privacy profiles that emerged from our database, from our data. So before I go into those six privacy profiles, let me talk to you a little bit about the most common privacy behaviors that our participants took on Facebook. The most common, probably because of the current defaults on Facebook, is that people limited their access control to share only to their friend network. Another common behavior was restricting their track availability so that they didn't show that they were online at all times. Now, moving down the rows, some of the more advanced privacy features that weren't used as frequently were sharing different content to different audiences through friend groups. How many of you knew that Facebook had that functionality before Google Circles even existed? Right, okay. So this gives us an idea across all users, the frequency of how they use these different privacy features. This web chart graphs all of the different privacy profiles all in one chart. So maximizers, selective sharers, and so forth are the six profiles that we determined through this data. If anybody's interested in looking at this as an interactive visualization, you can go ahead and look at the slides on my website that have this visualization for you to be able to play with. So now I'm going to go into the six privacy profiles that we found across the 308 users on Facebook. To some extent, their privacy management strategies ranged based on the frequency of use, from people who wanted a great deal of privacy to those who didn't really care that much at all. For instance, we have our privacy maximizers, which represented about only 10% of our survey respondents. And we're probably a lot like people in this room today. These are the people who just wanted all of the privacy, and so they took it upon themselves to use most of the privacy features, except for possibly some of the least commonly used ones overall. However, the largest profile that we had in our sample, we called privacy balancers, and these were 36% of our participants. These individuals tended to use the most common privacy settings, but didn't really engage as much with the more advanced privacy controls. The second largest group in our sample were privacy minimalists. What we found with these individuals is that they were often unaware of the advanced privacy settings and just did minimal management by limiting access control to friends only and then doing some level of self-censorship to manage their privacy. A more interesting profile is one that we found for our time savers, about 17% of our sample. These individuals were focused more on passive consumption, and they really just wanted to be left alone while doing so. So they minimize distractions by restricting their chat availability or altering their news feeds so that other people just wouldn't bother them while they were on their Facebook accounts. For example, from the interviews, we have a quote here from Tia, who suggested that she would just cut off people from her news feed because if she wanted to know about them, instead of them filtering into her news feed, she could just go to their page and check them out. 11% of our survey respondents fell into the category of self-censors. These were people who often mistrusted the access level controls that were provided to them, and so wanted to take their privacy into their own hands. So they often manage their privacy through self-censorship by not putting anything out there, such as Larry, who says that he only puts something on his Facebook that he would share with a stranger. However, what we also found through the interview study is that these users often felt fairly disconnected from their social networks and really didn't use it to garner that social connection that some of the other users. The smallest profile was our selective sharers. And in contrast to the self-censors who managed their privacy by not putting it out there, what these users did is they managed friend groups, and they shared content specifically to the groups that they wanted that intended content to go to. For an example, Alan here has an African-American niece and a racist father-in-law. Anybody have similar things with political views in your family? Yeah, and so he actually uses this mechanism to be able to share things with his family in a positive way, but leave out those who might cause those negative unintended consequences of sharing. So what are some of the key implications of this research? First, privacy strategies extend beyond disclosure decisions. It's not just about sharing or withholding personal information. It's about these myriad of different ways that we can manage our privacy that might look different than others. Some of the privacy settings we found were leveraged more often than others, and some ranged on a spectrum, while others had unique footprints where people were taking intentional action to manage their privacy in balance with how they wanted to socially connect with others. We also found that social networking site users employ different subsets of privacy features. So it's not always this on or off type of mechanism, and these behaviors exhibited a multi-dimensional pattern that really lended itself to unique privacy management strategies. One of the things that's interesting to look at from a design perspective is the frequency of use of the different privacy features. This might lend opportunities for privacy redesign for the features that people just don't use often because they probably don't meet their needs, or possibly some user education, such as many of our participants didn't realize that on Facebook you could actually share with limited groups. Also, profiling users in this way offers a number of new opportunities for thinking about how to manage or help users manage their privacy and security. For instance, what you might be able to do with such profiles is to create user personas and then use this in a user-centered approach to designing the user experience for how people can manage their privacy. To be able to personalize the systems that we use to the strategies that are most comfortable to us. We could also develop intelligent user interfaces and intelligent defaults, as well as recommending different privacy behaviors to different types of users based on their profile. Or, on the other hand, we might decide that we want to nudge people softly to become part of a different profile if that better suits their needs. So some of the next steps that I want to take in this research is really trying to understand the implications of these different profiles. Are there some that are associated with more positive outcomes for users than others? And if so, does it make sense ethically for us to try to change end user behavior in a way that better meets their needs? So some takeaways. Privacy is not a binary decision between disclosing and not disclosing information with others, and different people do it differently. Users can simultaneously share personal information with others and still care about their personal privacy. It doesn't have to be a zero-sum game, and we shouldn't always judge users if they're not managing their privacy in the way that we think that they should. And finally, it's important for us as HCI researchers and designers, as well as cybersecurity professionals, to give users multiple ways to manage their both informational privacy as well as their interactional personal boundaries with others. The reason for this is in contexts like social media, privacy is a secondary goal, not the primary goal of the end user. Thank you.